And when he gets up there, I mean, this is a teenage boy. He gets up there and he begins to find out what Goliath is doing, how stalemated the Philistines and the Israeli army is. And he gets righteous indignation. And he decides that if anybody's going to take on Goliath, he's going to take him on. So he goes after Goliath, and then you know it only takes one shot to knock Goliath in the head, and he falls flat on his face. And then for those of us who had Christian parents that told us that story, that amazing story of, you know, David slaying giants, that was the end of the story. But how many of you know it's not the end of the story? Our parents kind of shielded us from the gory part, which David takes Goliath's sword and chops off the giant's head. And then Israel takes the giant's head around with them as a trophy to remind the Philistines who won. Now, all that's well and good. Except 15-year-old boys aren't supposed to be going around chopping people's heads off. And David's history then turns from being the shepherd boy writing psalms outside the hills of Jerusalem to being a mighty warrior. And I know Rodney as a pastor, and I have as a pastor. Our friend Leif had a whole book on being giant slayers. And we have great messages on being giant slayers and giant killers and bringing down the giants. But the problem is, to go from a shepherd boy outside the hills of Jerusalem to be somebody who has a song sung about him, which is, Saul has slain his thousands, but David his tens of thousands, speaks of the kind of bloody war that David knew. As a matter of fact, David became so accustomed to killing that when Saul wanted to trap him, and hopefully, Saul had, by the way, the reward for David killing Goliath was that Saul would give David one of his daughters in marriage. So Saul was so jealous of David that he decided to trap him, and as part of the dowry to be able to, like the 8-cow wife that Rodney talked about this morning, Saul wanted his daughter to be a 100 foreskin wife. Yeah, everybody smile. And so he commands David to go out as part of his dowry to go get 100 foreskins of the Philistines. Now, guys, I mean, ladies, I want to tell you this. The guys already know this. But in order to get a foreskin from a man, you're going to have to kill him. We're not going to give it up voluntarily. I'm just going to say that. Just going to say that right now. Sorry if any of you are offended by that, but it's just the truth. David doesn't just bring 100 foreskins. He brings 200 foreskins. And he becomes a mighty man of war. You know that his story continues when eventually Saul tries to kill him, not once but twice. Eventually, for the next 13 years, he goes from being the Captain Israel of that nation to now being the most wanted man. And in the midst of it, he goes through Ziklag, which was a horrible traumatic experience. He goes through all this trauma as he's really trying to faithfully serve God. I mean, this is the man that's writing Psalms in the midst of his journey of running away from Saul. As a matter of fact, turn with me. I know I had you in Psalm 23, but go to Psalm 34 real quick. In Psalm 34, the heading of this passage says, A Psalm of David, when he feigned madness before Abimelech, who drove him away and he departed. In other words, David, as he was being persecuted and being hunted by the army of Israel, he went to Abimelech to try to find shelter and cover, and he discovered that Abimelech was not a safe person. And so he literally feigned madness to be able to get away from him. But it says in Psalm 34, verse 15, "The eyes of the Lord are toward the righteous, and his ears are open to their cry. The face of the Lord is against evildoers, to cut off the memory of them from the earth. The righteous cry, and the Lord hears, and delivers them out of all of their troubles. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted, and saves those who are crushed in spirit. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them out of them all. He keeps all his bones, not one of them is broken. Evil shall slay the wicked, and those who hate the righteous will be condemned. But the Lord redeems the soul of his servants, and none of those who take refuge in him will be condemned." What he's saying here is that even when you're following God and doing your best to stay in relationship with him, you're going to have some trouble. As a matter of fact, he makes it pretty clear, doesn't he? Many are the afflictions of the righteous. Now, I know that's not a refrigerator verse for you. But it's the truth. You see, when we talk about trauma, the little word trauma means to be wounded, to have a wound. It's not a mental illness. To carry unhealed trauma is not a mental disease. It's a soul injury. It's where how you think, how you feel, how you make choices, and your whole identity is shaped by the things that happen to you. Sometimes trauma comes because we've made bad choices, and the consequences of those bad choices end up in actually traumatizing us. But let's be clear, to carry unhealed trauma does not mean you're going crazy. It's not a mental illness. It's not a disorder. It's not a disease. It's a wound to your soul. And once you get that paradigm in your head, then you begin to understand how it's possible for God to bring his power to take the most traumatized, the most wounded, the most destroyed individual and restore them completely into the fullness of the dream of God for their lives. Could I get an agreement in the room, anybody? So in Psalm 23, David says this, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul." Now, I've read other paraphrases of this scripture, and because I like to read paraphrases in different translations. And some of them use the word refresh here. They make it sound like what David is talking about is a day at the spa, you know, where you get a pedicure and a manicure and sit in a hot tub and have somebody give you a facial or something like that. But that's not what the word restore means in the Old Testament. It's not a refreshing day at the spa. It is the term aruka, A-R-U-K-A-H. And the term is synonymous with the word restore that is used in the Old Testament in Deuteronomy, in the law that was given to the Jewish community, that were laws and restrictions and ways of dealing with things that happened within the larger community. And one of those laws had to deal with what happens when something is taken from you. When somebody in the community steals like a sheep, what happens when that person is caught, and what takes place? Well, for most of us, we would say, well, if the guy returns the sheep, then everything is okay. But guys, that's restitution. And restitution is not the same as restoration. The term aruka literally means to restore back to better than it was before you suffered the trauma of losing that thing. In other words, in some of the law, you had to replace that sheep with 4 to 7 times as many sheep as the one that you stole. So that not only did you receive restitution, that you got your original sheep back, but you got even more than that. So you ended up being better off than you were before. When David talks about that the Lord restores his soul, understand the kind of trauma that David went through. He knew what it was to be rejected by his family. He knew what it was to be a bloody man of war. He knew what it was to be rejected by the entire nation. He knew what it was to be betrayed. How many of you know that at Ziklag, he went through what a lot of pastors go through? You know, you as a pastor, any pastors in the room? Who's a pastor? God, come on, give it up for our pastors, will you? But you know, when you're a pastor, you're a shepherd, so you're supposed to lay down your life for your sheep. And then sometimes when things go wrong or somebody gets a crossways with you or they don't like what you're preaching or teaching anymore, you go through as a pastor what David went through in Ziklag.